We have on our program today four women who were married to famous people. And they discovered that there is quite a sisterhood. It exists everywhere, but it's most focused in Southern California, where all of us are, where a lot of people sell a lot of newspapers, not to mention magazines, by writing about the trials and the troubles of famous couples, marriages. What's it like, for example, for these women to walk into the supermarket and see their husband's picture on the front page of a celebrity magazine standing next to another woman? What do you say to the kids? What happens? Is there a special pressure that these women feel? And how do they resolve it? We have with us Billie Jean Campbell, the former wife of singer Glen Campbell. Also here is Lynn Landon, who was married to Michael Landon. Marilyn Funt also joins us, the former wife of Alan Funt. And finally, Jackie Joseph, who was married for quite a while to Ken Berry. Where are these people emotionally now? Is it over for them? Is there any pain? Do they feel they somehow need to be exact revenge? And what caused the breakup? And is it any of our business? And what's in it for us to talk to people like this? They think quite a lot. They think they've seen the world, so to speak, and what they have to say to you might just be helpful to those who are sustaining the pain of what they may think will be a divorce. Can your marriage be saved? And when do you know when to push? How do you know when to push the eject button? We'll talk about all that, and we hope you'll join us. Billie Jean Campbell married Glen before he was big. I mean, you guys were struggling, weren't you, when you got married?
Yes, you could put it that way. In the beginning, it was very difficult.
Where was this? Was this Nashville?
In the beginning, no. Albuquerque. It started in Albuquerque, New Mexico. My home is Carlsbad, and I moved to Albuquerque, met Glen.
How did that happen? Just very briefly.
Well, I was working as a hairdresser, and I moved to the big city, Albuquerque. And I just looking around town, finding the best place to dance and have a good time, and his band happened to be that. So That's how I met him.
Now, and then you were married shortly thereafter?
Pretty shortly. We met in January, and we're married in September.
Right. How many children, Billy?
Three. I have three children.
And I think you helped him. You were almost his agent, weren't you? You didn't, in the early go, I mean.
Well, kind of. I played a role of a little bit of agent and answering service, but yeah, a little bit of all of it.
But Glen always did well before he was hot. He made quite a bit of money as a studio musician.
After about 3 years, after moving to L.A., it took about 3 years, and by that time he had established a very good reputation as a guitarist.
And his secretary would call and ask you to make decisions about which place you might want to socialize. Is that so? Do I have that?
It started out that way in the beginning. I wasn't that happy with it, so I kind of let him know and her know that the social end of it was my department. And
I'm not sure I know what you mean. You mean that you wanted to make the decisions about what was to happen in your private social
life?
Rather
than being informed, yes.
I see. You didn't want to be told. You wanted to have a participate in the decision, not
exactly.
Altogether an unreasonable request. When did you suspect something was maybe problem? How long had you been married?
16. We were married 16 years.
How old were you when you married him?
20.
And
35 divorced. So I've been coming 10 years.
You know the song, I Followed You to Tucson?
No.
I followed you everywhere, and now where are you? I don't know if that necessarily reflects what you... So 16 years of, I suppose, a marriage that, like everybody else, has had its ups and downs, but no real crisis.
No. I consider myself very lucky. 16 years of marriage and about 14 happy. The last couple of years, it took about 2 years for me to realize that the partnership that we had going, we were kind of, you know, at its end.
And what was the evidence?
Mainly lack of communication, not feeling, first in the beginning, me not feeling enough a part of the roles that I always played with Glen. and which were very involved. And then two, I think my age, and I wanted to be my wife, Billie, rather than just my wife. I wanted to be Billie and establish a name. By the time I think one's 30, you kind of start taking a more of a look at yourself.
Right. So then the divorce was a mutual decision, or no?
Well, I asked Lynn to leave. I knew that we either needed time apart to try to get back together, or there was no trial separation. That was his feeling. So I thought, well, it's a must. So I asked him to leave.
You didn't have any, was there another woman involved?
No. Well, I say no so confidently. I mean, I don't know, 10, 15 years down the road,
yeah.
I might find out differently, because with my wonderful group that we now have going here, I've learned a lot.
But it sounds like you weren't dumped.
No, I never really considered myself dumped, no.
Lynn Landon met Michael while he was an extra on Bonanza?
No. I was working extra.
Oh, he was in.
He
was the star at the time?
Right. Michael was on about the second year of Bonanza.
Right away, wow, huh?
Uh-huh, right away, wow.
And how long were you married?
19 years.
How many children?
We had four together.
Uh-huh. And what happened, Lynn?
What happened?
When did the yellow light first go on for you?
Similar to Billie, about the 17th year, I noticed a change. I thought it was Michael's health. I thought he was being overworked.
He was producing Little House?
Yes.
And that's considerably more pressure than being a...
Tremendous amount of pressure. And Michael had high blood pressure and so forth and so on. So the changes I saw, I contributed. Yeah. To Michael's health.
Wouldn't it be great if it was always hypoglycemia? We could do something.
It'd be wonderful if they shot her.
So,
pill.
Were there any? Were you frightened or what?
In the beginning, no. I don't think I was frightened. As it went along, yes.
What frightened you?
Just the changes that were going on.
How much hurt was there in this? Was there another woman?
I'd rather have Michael talk about that. Really.
But you, well, I know that this is very complicated, but you must have felt as though he turned his back on you, did you?
Yes.
Now that's the hurt part, isn't it?
There is so much pain involved with something like that I don't even know if you can pinpoint what it is. Your whole world comes crumbling down around you.
I think definitely there is more pain if another person is involved.
I would think so.
Yes, except I've come to realize that it really didn't have anything to do with another person. It had everything to do with Michael, not just someone else in his life.
What is this all we get from big stars in Hollywood, about 17 years? Marilyn Funt is in here. Are you saying yes to that as the ex-wife of Alan Funt?
No, I'm saying yes to that perhaps as the count for marriage. I don't
show
know.
Me a wealthy guy, famous, with a big car and attention at everybody's party, a hit, and I'll show you a guy who can't get past the 17th year of marriage. Is this the story?
No. Look at John Forsythe.
Certainly there are exceptions. This is not to say that this is necessarily everybody's lot, and Hollywood wants us to know that there are Jimmy Stewart.
Hopes.
Gregory Peck's.
Lynn was just saying it wasn't exactly the other woman. I think in one respect what you were saying was it could have been any woman at that time. It isn't this particular woman that changed their life. It's that Michael at that time had changed enough that another woman would have been in the picture. I'm having trouble seeing you.
But if I lean over, they won't be able to see you.
Okay.
How about you? What? Tell us about...
Okay, everyone's story is different, just as all of yours are different. I, in a sense, was perhaps the other woman at my time. Alan is and was considerably, he's still about the same amount of years older than me. There's a 23-year age difference. And I was working for Candid Camera right out of college, and several years later I was sort of on the pension plan when we married. But for me, our coming apart was ultimately Barbie doll started to grow up, and that was not what the original contract was all about.
You're Barbie doll at the time.
I was Barbie doll.
Right.
Hopefully, I am no longer Barbie doll. And there was an enormous amount of difficulty in terms of my need to surface as a person, which I thought would never be a problem because I thought, gee, emotionally, how lucky I am now. I'll never have to do anything. He's got all the identity, all the success, all the creativeness, and I just kind of tag along for the ride. It'll be terrific.
But he had difficulty adjusting to this, is that right?
Well, without the difficulty was a long process. I also, 17 years, the magic number, two children. But it was a long process, and ultimately there was going to be a murder, not another woman, in our coming apart. And when there are children involved, you never come apart. I think we all kind of know that.
We come apart, but we maintain.
Right. We should say that all these women are single. Jackie Joseph was married to Ken Berry. You met Ken, I think, in Las Vegas?
Well, no, we were working in Hollywood in a show that ran for years and years called The Billy Barnes Review. So it was backstage romance. We were kids. And the kids we were then were just perfect for each other. And I think what happened...
How old were you at the time?
22. And then we were engaged several years, and we were married, I'm afraid to say, 17 years.
17 years.
Yes, it. And
people are checking their calendars out.
I think what happened at the time is that the man that Ken became and the woman that I became, I was not adequate for his needs at that time. So I wish I had the support group then, because you go through the, oh, I'm inadequate, oh, it's me, oh, what have I done, which is all dumb stuff to do, of which we'll talk about later. Really, it was time to move on.
But that's what you're saying that now.
Yeah.
Oh, missed together all, no.
Hey, I had a group for a year. Yeah.
No, there's nobody.
But at the time, you are a maniac.
Really?
You are terrified. You're standing on ground and suddenly it isn't there anymore. I'm the kind of person who pretends you're okay all the time. So I just was being perky the whole time. You know, it's my, as I've learned, it's my device to get through.
Yeah. We have a lot of problems with her in the group.
I drive her crazy because I smile too much.
You're a liar.
I love it.
But in the process, I assume you were denying your own real pain. Is that true?
In the process, I had a back surgery and a front surgery. I mean, all my real pain went elsewhere.
Right. Did you drink?
No, I'm just now learning to drink.
I don't have to tell you that has been known to happen to.
You're talking about after.
Yeah, during the limbo of during the immediacy of the crisis. I mean, you know, there you are in the house.
I didn't start drinking. Started smoking a little grass.
It's another form of illness.
Which was easier?
Less batten.
Yes, it's another form of what?
Of illness. Those who had to turn to drink.
Right. Now, are you here to say that you really have emotionally thrown off this pain and that you feel good about it? You all look wonderful, so it's clear you're taking care of yourself, which is the first.
It keeps getting better.
Yeah,
that's
each year
the important
helps
thing.
A lot.
We're in process. We're in process every day and in progress. And just since we have been together.
From the beginning of the group, the difference in a couple of ones that just have separated, I mean, the difference in them in a year and a half almost is amazing.
Right. Ladies, what's the acronym mean?
Life after divorce is eventually sane.
That's exactly.
You meet once a week or what?
No, once a month.
Once a month. And many of the, most of the women with whom you are gathering are women who, like yourselves, are married to famous faces.
In our
all of them.
Immediate
must,
group,
right.
There are only women who have been married to famous men.
Because celebrities.
We felt, in the coming together, in the very early stage, we came together as a result of realizing that there were very special problems that had only to do with if you had been married to a famous man. And that in some sense, there was a lack of understanding or sympathy out there, which made getting over it even harder. And we felt the need just to be together, to say terrible things or wonderful things or personal things about idols that right. Everyone else really doesn't quite believe you because they have an image. And we needed each other to do that. We needed to laugh. We needed to say all kinds of personal and intimate things that we could only say to each other. And what has happened as a result, first of all, laughter is terrific, and when it comes in a support group, it really has a very kind of medicinal effect, is the anger is being dissipated. We're all here for different reasons.
Yeah.
One you can call dumped, one has left, whatever, but everyone was angry and hurt.
Yeah. Did you, you had to deal with the front page of those celebrity magazines.
Yeah.
Every day.
It wasn't
one of the rags or a magazine or a TV guide or People. Then you flipped your TV on and there was a promo, and my former husband was on twice a day. I mean, old reruns of Bonanza and then Little House and then...
The luck I've had, I turn off the TV and don't watch it, and then the radio goes on, so I
start singing.
It's like he comes out of the sky, doesn't
yeah.
he?
Yeah.
Listen to your own cassette. Yeah.
Listen to this letter that Ladies has had a good deal of publicity, so that many women who are facing similar problems around the country have written to these women, including this one. Here's part of what this woman said. I am almost 69 years old, married for 48 years to an executive. It wasn't always that way, meaning he wasn't always an executive. Now it seems he has been enamored by his secretary for quite some time and wants out. I have never worked outside the home. I have grandsons older than her son, and I am frightened. It is extremely traumatic for anyone at any age, but I just do not know how I will cope. So, how do we keep our daughters out of this? I mean, there are women out there that are just totally without any support at all.
That's
we know that
a lot.
Which
a lot
is why we're here, by the way. Yeah.
And there are women today that are much older than it used to be in terms of being left. Somehow, with all the wonderful things that are happening that are keeping people alive a lot longer, it means that marriage is lasting a lot longer. And maybe there is a cutoff point, 17 years or whatever, when you've, in a sense, had the experience. But women in their late 50s and early 60s, whose entire life was their marriage,
yeah,
and everything that meant, are being left by insurance men who need hair transplants for their careers. And all of a sudden, the double standard surfaces where a man still somehow is attractive and a woman is a nice lady.
Yeah.
And it's very, you know, rough out there, and that is the kind of pain when that woman has no background to
right,
go back to that's other than the marriage.
Is the caller there? Hi.
Yes, I'd rather have my divorce spread through the papers and be well provided for than to be on food stamps and never know when my next support check will
that's
come.
That's a good point.
Yeah.
Right.
That's a good point. I also
You understand that, don't you?
Very
yes.
much so. Can I speak
sure,
to that?
Sure, go right ahead.
Go ahead, Jackie.
I'm on my own. And I know how it is. I just happen to be a positive thinker, and I know some great job is coming. I don't know what it is yet, but it's going to come because I elected to...
I don't know if it's fair to penalize these women necessarily, because they might have been fortunate to get a settlement that is not available to most women, and without necessarily... It's none of our business. But it is true that they do have some help that so many other women don't.
Is it rich or poor or old or young? Pain is pain is pain is pain.
Yeah. As money, an example,
money doesn't help.
Her food stamp.
Yeah. Wait, I was just going to say, money does not help the emotional pain. I felt hurt no matter what was coming about. I saw my children crying, pulling everything together. Money does not buy off that sort of thing. In fact, what we're going to try and do is bring light to a lot of these women's problem. We're meeting tomorrow with displaced homemakers, hopefully to call attention to a lot of what women are going through, and we hope that it will help women like the one that's just calling.
Yeah. Let me get this. Are you there?
Yes, I'm there.
Go
I
ahead.
Have a question for Phil Donahue.
Yes.
I was wondering how your wife felt about being divorced from a famous person.
I think it's more difficult, but I don't think it's the... I think it's the tip of the iceberg. I think most of the problem has to
that's
do with
right. that. I think we have to address that issue a little bit more seriously and a little bit more in depth, because it cannot, I feel, be dismissed by saying ultimately it's just the pain, because I think we're talking about separate issues.
Right. And we're not dismissing it either.
No.
It's just that we just want to point out that you can lose your happily ever after whether you're a rich person or a poor person.
No, but
her
example
something,
was like
there's
if
something
we had,
more
we
than
didn't
what's
have
up,
to
Billy
worry about.
Go ahead, Billy. Go ahead.
So
no, we appreciate your enthusiasm.
Well, her example was having money and then having to get food with stamps. Mm-hmm. And relatively, it's all the same problem, whether, you know, you're having to use food stamps, or whether the problem or the worry is about, okay, now are they going to come up with the money for the college, whether it's your children in college and it's that money that you're concerned about, or their future, you know, their future support, or going to the market and using food stamps. Relatively, again, at what level?
But we cannot back up from the fact that it's easier if you don't have to.
See, the reason we're here is that we're aware that there are people out there who are broke, and that is the bottom line sad thing, that they don't know where to get a job, they don't know where to turn, they don't know who to talk to. They write us long letters because they have no one else to talk to, and so we have a message to help you. We care about you. That's why we're here.
Give us the briefest message, Jackie. What did you go to the health spa? What did you do?
No.
Did you get an analyst?
None of that stuff counts. 1-2-3, the biggest, cheapest healing in town is to get a support group. That could be one friend or one stranger who is in your boat.
Right.
Then they'll each know somebody, and you have a little potluck, and you talkity-talkity-talk, and you get better. I promise you. Number two, if the emotional help isn't what you need, there are places out there. But when you're just divorced and your life is over, your brains run out your ears. You don't know that. So you can contact the Displaced Homemakers Network in Washington, D.C., or write to us. We'll give you our little P.O. box.
We will send it forward.
Well, there's someone in your area who you can turn to.
Are you there? Hello.
Is you there?
Hi.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, I'm on hold.
Go right ahead. You're on the air.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am. We're waiting for you. Go ahead.
Okay. I'm calling to say that I feel that men go through a midlife crisis. They think they're not cute or sexy anymore. They get this crotch itch.
They get what?
Crotch itch.
They get what?
That's what
I have a...
If that's the case, then we're going to sell a lot of Desinex. Let's not miss her point. Let's see if we can't. Men look in the mirror and they say, "My goodness, I'm getting old," or in maybe with less, more vulgar language. And the way to prove that you aren't is to find a younger girl. Is that it?
Yes, to tell you that you're cute, your tummy isn't big, your hair isn't getting gray, it isn't falling out.
Yeah.
And I think wives should fight harder, hang in longer. A lot of these divorced men would love to go back 2 years later. They go through a physiological, psychological mess.
You think so? You think they're sorry they left their first spouse?
A lot of times, yes.
Well, how are you doing?
I was divorced 18 years ago. I have been dating the same man for 16 years. And 2 years ago, he got a crotch itch.
He didn't make it to 17.
One more year.
I think a crotch
itch. It happened to be a little technical.
Crotch itch is a very good way of describing what happens. I think, but what it is that ultimately a lot of things are coming around so that a man at that stage somewhere knows that he can go out there and take another shot. And the shot is with a young girl or whatever.
A woman's more realistic about
her aging.
It's also more complicated than that, I'm afraid to say.
That's an easy
answer. Yeah. You have to wonder... you know, how much male dominance and the society that is controlled by males, in which males make the decisions, in which there are so many women out there who grew up with fathers who went like this to their mothers and who walk right into the same pattern of behavior. I don't think it's about sex, or that is to say about men and women. I think it's about power. And here's my point. If women had the same kind of power that men enjoy today, which is largely in many ways not recognized still in spite of the women's movement, if women had the same power, I think women would be as capable of the kind of behavior that we've decried in men. Do you know what I mean?
I guess the basic thing is to teach everybody's children what commitment really means, how to work a little harder, as your caller said.
No, but he's not addressing what Phil said. He's talking about something.
About the power.
is a very, you're right, because women are in fear of being left because the power is frequently financial, right. Or most of the time it's financial. And that's why a woman is so devastated. The letter that you read, where does that lady go? Where the man takes his power with him and he gives her what he ultimately really chooses to give, because there are so many ways that, as we have known, that the financial situation is worked out not necessarily in an equitable way. I think you have touched on the much more important aspect of this.
And it's also easier for men to flirt than it is for women.
That's true.
And in other words, if the flirting that men do were accepted in women, I think we'd be finding matchbooks on you.
Well, I'm trying to learn.
Good. Let me get one more. Are you there? Hi.
Hi.
Go ahead.
If I were their ex-husbands, I'd be mad that they're bringing all this on television. Aren't they irritated?
What are we bringing on television?
No, they
don't
haven't really.
Do you think something should be left private and it's up to you to keep some of your life
private? It's been on the tabloids. It's not theirs.
Right.
The decision about privacy was not theirs to make.
Right.
Well,
that's one problem.
They don't need to drag it through anymore.
But what are we dragging through?
No, we really
want
to leave that behind.
That's our intention, dragging it through. And as far as hearing from our exes, I haven't heard from mine yet. And hopefully, maybe I will.
One of the things I realize is that if you're talking about power, our names have power. So we have decided, as we came together personally for our own self-support and our needs, that all of a sudden this power was there, that we could do something worthwhile. And I think anyone who has an opportunity to do something worthwhile really should just do it.
Right.
Because it makes you feel better. Our relating to a lot of other women is helping all of us become more real, and we need to become
more
real.
It's obvious that we're here because of who our ex-husbands are. I started to say we're. But because we've got your attention and because you were nice enough to invite us, this is our opportunity to say, ladies out there, you're not alone, which is a common thread of our letters. You don't have to be frightened. You don't have to be embarrassed. See, when you're divorced, no one comes and brings you cookies and a cake.
True.
You know, it's like in a death.
Yeah.
It's like an embarrassing. Forget it. Also, if men have more power, let it go. What can you do about it?
Change
and if someone
it.
Did
you
something
can, yes,
to you,
they did
what they did because they did, forget it.
I got a break. I promise you, we want this audience in this thing. Thanks for calling. We'll be back in a moment.
My question is, you lovely ladies, would you still be married if your husbands were not as famous as they are? Do you think your marriage would have lasted?
I think mine would have. Because we married when... it was zip, zero, nothing, and it was fun. In fact, that was the best of times. Lady?
That's what's funny. I mean, when you finally achieve a certain financial position and everything, why do you always remember the good old days when you were struggling? Maybe it holds you together a little bit more than your values are a little different.
Changes somewhat.
Are all your husbands remarried now?
Michael is.
Yeah,
Glenn is. Ken is living with a wonderful lady for years and years. She's devoted to him. No one can take better care of him. I mean, no, she is. She's good. We talk. I like her.
She brings him chicken soup every week.
I was wondering if you've ever thought about finding real young men and dating them and just kind of being with them and seeing if you
can get even.
We've done more than think
about
it.
No, you see all the time about women are marrying, you know, younger men nowadays. I was just wondering if you'd ever thought about that.
Most of the men I've gone out with are younger than I am. But that wasn't on purpose. It's just how it's happened.
Yes.
Do you think it would have been any less devastating if you had had careers and if you were financially on your own?
For me, the answer is a big yes. I realize that now, and it never even entered my mind when I married. I was the prototype of most women at our age, which is to, would you like to leave the room?
Yeah, me too.
For me, no, because I always had a career. And I always worked, it was limited, I wouldn't leave the country or town or anything like that. So that's why I use my own name.
I lost my identity, which was my fault, but in having the children, and I was being the kind of wife Michael wanted at that time. It was what I wanted at that time, too.
I was totally devastated because my career was wife and mother. And once the wife dropped, the mother became more difficult. And not having a career other than that, it was much harder.
Well, one of the things, the role of wife and mother in a regular kind of marriage really requires the kind of involvement that in some respects I know I didn't put in. I ended up being involved with a lot of things other than my own children, which was very disappointing, and I felt I missed that experience.
In your support group, do you just meet together, just came together? Do you have like any kind of psychologist?
We haven't started with any guest speakers yet, but our plan is, we're starting now.
So far, it's just been us.
We haven't just needed us. Anyone.
It works terrific, because we can relate to each other.
And everyone is at different levels of divorce, mm-hmm. too.
Now, we've read about some of the other women who have attended. I don't think there's any invasion of privacy.
We have some that are anonymous and some that are not, so obviously the names that you do have you can speak about. But
Patty Lewis has come.
Yes, she sends you her love. She's our inspiration, yeah.
Please return it for me.
We
and,
will.
And who else is on record here?
Marion Siegel.
Marion Siegel.
George Siegel's ex-wife.
And Patty McLeod, who's doing better and better and better.
Gavin McLeod's ex-wife.
Her healing has been slow because her pain. You know, we all heal at different levels.
Marianne Conway.
I'm sorry.
Pardon?
Marianne Conway, you said.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Are you there?
Yes.
Go ahead. Not much time, sir.
I'd like to know, did drugs play a major part in breaking up any of their relationships?
Did what?
Drugs.
I think that's a question no one would want to answer if it did or didn't.
Except there's been some publicity, hasn't there, on some of these?
I don't know. Not on our husbands.
May I just compliment you women on not using this forum to badmouth your husbands. And furthermore, in spite of your pain, you seem to have surfaced as stronger women.
Thank you. That's our intention.
That's
your help.
And we'll be back in just a moment.
I'd like to know how the children are adjusting.
Mine are doing very well now. And I think an important message to get out there to ladies who are hurting, and believe me, no one could have been more angry than I was at one time, is try and leave the children out of that. In other words, that's their father, and he will always be their father, and they love him very much.
Pardon? Is it possible, she said?
Yes, it is possible. Yes.
It takes a while. I mean, in the beginning, it's very difficult to leave them out, but...
Right. If you realize you're only hurting them by bad-mouthing an ex or something. In other words, I want my children to be as secure as they can be.
Over here, Frank.
I think that part of the problem is with society, meaning that you're all divorced, and now the new wives are all in the limelight. And it's like
we don't all have new wives to contend with.
Yeah. Two of us.
But I mean, now the husbands can go with their new wives to all the social things, and people accept that.
Right.
Right.
And I think that it's disturbing that society allows it.
That's what would knock me down. I mean, one of the things is Saturday night, you know, after years and years of a kind of routine of socializing and being in pairs and so on,
right,
you're out of business.
Yeah, but for many of us, one of the aspects of that was that we really didn't exist. We only existed when the man was standing next to us. Otherwise, as Kate Mostel once said, that she said, if these people know me so well to kiss me, they could at least recognize my face when I'm not with him. Now, there's an experience of being talked to or listened to, whatever, for yourself that's new.
I was wondering if you think it's some kind of a plateau or something in the 17th year. I was divorced in the 17th year also.
We've heard from hundreds and hundreds of people, and it goes the whole from just a few years to 40, 50 years.
What's shocking now is how many marriages that are 30, 40 years are coming apart. You used to say if someone was married in 20s or whatever, why did they get a divorce? That's one of the terrible things that are happening to women now, being left at very, very late stages in their lives. There's a group called the Gray Panthers, women that are much older and being...
Is the caller there? Hi. Go ahead. Is the caller there?
Are you there?
Yes, go ahead, please. Can you hear me? She's not there. I thought I heard her. I don't want to waste her nickel. Sir.
I'm kind of concerned about your kids. Is there any kind of group that they can go to with you or themselves to kind of recover? It's got to be an awful lot.
It's terrible on them, and I think that's a terrific idea.
A very secure family. We have fun.
That's great.
And I'm imagining your family's very secure, right, too, when you're together.
One thing that's, there is some good, if you can say that, that comes out of divorce. In other words, I'm closer now to my children than ever before.
It's true of me.
Yeah. And...
But I think it would be interesting for some of our children, we've already talked about this, to get together and date. Compare
notes
also.
I think it's more devastating to them.
It's unrealistic because of their lives, but I think the point that you're making is really very important, if that was possible to bring them together. Anyone who share, children, adults who share a common pain, getting together is what it's all about. That's why we're here.
Over here, please.
I'm curious as if, have these experiences soured you? I'll never marry anybody famous again. It'll always be a nobody, or would you give it a
That's nobody. Individual with everyone. That was my feeling right after the divorce. I really felt very hostile to the whole notion of marriage. I'm now working on a book about successful marriages, and my attitude has changed. I've seen some great couples out there are better together.
No, I'm not soured now, maybe in the beginning, but I want to know where he's coming from, hopefully.
Be hard not to be.
Because you get scared.
Yeah.
Yes, but to me, it's going to be here. Where he's
over here.
From.
Yeah, just a question. Would you do it again?
Do what?
Do what?
Married again?
Get married or marry a famous man.
Definitely.
Same question.
Well, she wants to know if you had it to do over again, would you marry your husbands as you did?
Oh, a husband?
No regrets. Besides my marriage, I have three beautiful children, and
that's it.
I had a wonderful marriage, and I really found out what love and marriage was about.
So I had a good marriage for a lot of years, and I have four beautiful children, and I wouldn't change that for anything.
Is the caller there? Let's try this again.
Yes, I am.
Go ahead.
Well, I've been married 17 years.
Whoops.
And I'm a little threatened here. But we're suffering some of the same disenchantments at this point that I've heard you talk about, and I'm wondering if... In hindsight, you have anything to offer that at that point you would have done differently to keep your marriage together?
Do you have anything to worry about? I mean,
well, as I said, we're going through a very difficult period where we don't like each other very much.
I'll tell you, talk
keep
about what you don't like.
Communication open.
Talk, don't guess.
My advice would just be to seek help and find a support group, two of you possibly.
Do you talk about it?
Oh, sure.
Do you understand what ails him?
Well, it's not just him, it's us.
It's not what?
It's not just him, it's an us situation.
Yeah, do you know what bothers you?
Well, it's being married 17 years.
Okay. Do you still love him?
Do you still love him, she asked?
Oh, yes, I believe
work
that we
it
both
out.
Do.
Work it out, right.
But what advice, each of you have said that you had good years of marriage.
Yes.
And so at, say, the 15-year point, you had to suffer some sort of disenchantment. What would you have done differently at that point?
Well, see, disenchantment is a little tiny problem. Someone not wanting you anymore is flat out, goodbye, it's over. You know.
See, to me, marriage is really a gift to each other. And when that gift reaches the point where it's not a gift that you're really wanting to receive, well, then it's the person's decision.
It's understanding, it's commitment.
Yeah. How many children?
Two.
Well,
it's your problem. She
doesn't sound as if she knows why they're coming apart.
Are you bored?
I think that's part of the problem. As I said, some of the same problems we've had, we started out struggling, the struggle gave you purpose, and now we've work together in a business and achieved a financial success, but we're in a plateau.
But she's suspecting crotch itch.
Oh.
Exactly.
Is that the basis?
Let's just say it's a very tough world out there. If you have a man you love, find something else that will interest you.
but do you think he's bored?
Possibly. I don't know if he knows whether he's bored or not.
But how much of a will do you think is there to save this?
Well...
See, that's the whole thing.
I see us in a decline, but not really knowing how to stop it.
So you don't know whether you might... Do you wonder whether you'd be happy or divorced?
Yes.
What
we both do.
What is it that you want to do, though?
No, you don't want her to. Hang
that
on.
You can't
is that right?
Do.
Hang on.
Married.
Yeah.
Why hang on?
What?
Why hang on?
Right?
She wants you to hang on.
Oh,
hang on.
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
You say work it out. Could you have worked yours out?
If we could have, we would
have. You have to have two people
we
that are willing.
Well, you're telling her to work it out. Well,
no, she's still together. She's still together.
What I think we're saying is when you finally, if you do come apart, know that you've made an enormous effort not to, and ultimately at some point you know whether you have to come apart.
Yeah.
To walk too soon.
Yeah. Are you there?
Yes,
go ahead.
The point I want to say is, Phil, I could spend 3/4 of my day taking care of my husband's needs, picking up his dirty socks, magazines, cleaning up the bedroom, and fixing supper. What these women should do is they should have stayed home and taken care of their husbands. They wouldn't have to come and sit on talk shows.
Oh, no, no.
How long have you been married?
I can tell you that much.
How long have you been married?
17 years.
And you're happy?
That's
17
right.
years?
I take care of my husband, and I don't have to be dependent to go on your show someday and try to tell other women.
All right. But you don't have any concern at all about your marriage.
No, I love my husband, and he loves me, and the only way I would ever have to get separated is if, God forbid, he should die. And that's what they should have been doing instead of...
You're very lucky. I was with my husband all the time. I was with him every day. He never went anywhere on a location trip that I didn't go.
Yeah.
3/4 of my time was cleaning the house and chasing the kids and all of it. Yeah,
well, we're happy for you, but I think the record shows that it doesn't work for all women. And there's also a lot of resentment builds up if women do that much for someone else. I got a break. We'll be back in just a moment.
You were saying...
Well, let me give this address. That's important. LADIES is the acronym for what?
Life After Divorce Is Eventually Sane.
Box 2974, Beverly Hills, California. The zip is 90213. These are women who've gone through the whole complicated emotion of separation and divorce and are now giving each other support and also sharing their experiences with other women who are similarly
in trouble. Trying to connect all the names, too, from the letters we get with a computer so that we can keep these women in touch with each other.
Yeah. You were saying earlier that you regretted the fact that you don't have a career, except Jackie says, well, you had a career with your husband as the wife and supporting
him.
No, I don't regret that I didn't have a career. What I'm asking, though, is do you feel that now, that this is your career? I feel that it is because you're trying to help
this
women
group?
Throughout the country.
Oh, yes.
This group is part of my life right now, but I do have other work, and for me, work has been the panacea in a sense of trying to rebuild and create an identity that I very, very much need.
This group has been an outflowing, a way to give to other people what we got from each other.
Over here.
While each of you all were going through your divorce, what were some of the things you did to occupy yourself while you were
I stayed in bed a lot.
A lot of everything.
No particular routine then?
Oh, no, there are things to do. Exercise, Lynn?
Right, I tried to release my anger by exercising. In other words, I tried to do something constructive. I wasn't really able to think.
Things you never thought you were worth doing before. Take a special class, buy yourself something swell.
Don't make any major decisions.
Went out dancing a lot.
I particularly didn't... Oh, I'm sorry.
Started jogging.
Didn't go out on dates a lot because I felt that's... comes from a certain kind of fear that women have, and they rush out in their dating, and it's only more confusing. I wanted to kind of get in touch with myself.
I still don't go out on dates. I'm
over here.
Do you think that your husband's being famous, that emotionally they had problems, perhaps? Was it hard for them to be famous?
That's an important question.
I think that's a tough thing to deal with.
It's individual, though.
Fame and power.
Back here, friend.
Added to it from
this. Did you love your husbands when all this is going on, and how do you feel about them now?
When what was all going on?
The divorce. I adored my husband, and now I love him as a dear friend. We're going to go see a show. We're going to see Joanne Worley, who we worked together in Gypsy.
Yeah.
And,
with his wife?
Not together. No, with his. He's going with his lady. I'm going with my friend. Sometime I'll find a fella.
I loved him, but I no longer was in love with him.
You still love him.
Right.
I will always love the years I had with Michael. We had a lot of good years together. We have all these children together. You don't wipe that out.
I don't know what you call love anymore. I'm still quite involved with my ex-husband. Love and hate, you know, the ends of the same extreme.
It's,
I don't
a
know,
word
it's an
problem.
Emotional situation that continues.
But those who carry anger as a millstone for 20 years saying, oh, I hate him, what a waste of time.
You're
defeating
yourself. But
at least
yourself.
For 6 months you could have had a little
oh,
anger.
Oh, for a good year.
Oh, yes.
Would you let a man who was married to a famous woman into your group?
Would you let a man who was married to a famous woman come to your support group? Sure.
We've talked about that.
Oh, not yet. Oh, I'm sorry.
When we have our party, singles party, then they're all invited.
Are you there? I don't have much time.
Yes. I'm in my 29th year of marriage, and we came from a small town.
Yeah?
Yes?
Yeah?
I'm in my 29th year of marriage.
Yeah, and you came from a small town, and you became rich, and now it's over?
Well, he's devoted to his work. It's not really another woman, and he claims that everything's fine, but yet it's not.
Yeah.
That happens. Yeah.
Well, then make your own life.
You have to make your own life, as they say, as simple as it is. I'm sorry to not have more useful information for you under the gun that we are here. A life after divorce is
eventually
sane. Box 2974, Beverly Hills, California. The zip is 90213. Tell them how you feel. Why not? I know you join me in thanking these women for a very important program, and we thank you for being with us.
Services provided and promotional fees paid by the following.
Here's one wagon you can drive years before unloading.
True Value really is more than a name. It's your assurance of finding great values, outstanding selection, plus friendly personal service at your nearby True Value hardware store or home center.